what is a wrong saddle? Well, it starts off by, well, if you ask, who do you want to ask? You ask a saddle fitter, a saddle maker, or should we ask a medical doctor? Okay? A medical doctor who say there is massive difference between the female and the male pelvis. And if the saddle is not built correctly to the gender appropriate person, then you will cripple the rider. But the horse in the end pays the price. So we have the interface between the pelvis, skeleton of the rider. We have the movement of the horse, the skeleton of the horse. And of course, we have, as I said, veterinarians who now say, if you ride wrong, the back, right? Also training, you know, if it's either bad saddle, because you have not a female saddle, because you're female, you ride in a male saddle, or you're male and you ride it in the female saddle and you don't even know, you know, because your saddle fitter or salesperson never give you the chance to try both genders. So even though you're a girl, I will definitely recommend try both saddles. The same model, same company, try the male and the female version. The difference is day and night, and it's not just for you, for the horse, because the horse will not cramp and get tight on the neck like you see here on this horse. Okay, tight, 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 bracing in the base of the withers and then curling behind the vertical. And then of course the lumbar sacral joint is a gotta go, right? So if we understand, okay, and we want to learn to people who studied and flown around the world just like me, veterinarians to really can go to the detail, right? Then I, as a manufacturer, or as a saddle ergonomist, or a person who rides, loves horses, should never, ever, ever question people who understand how these animals work. So Schlaeser, the company who I make saddles with, follows the saddle fit for life philosophy, which is making saddles and for rider and horses. And horses will tell you, this lady here wrote an article about the horse's pain. Okay, so they talk. Horses don't lie. Look at their eyes, their face, right? So we know horses can communicate not with English or German or Portuguese. They have what we also have, body language. And when you approach a horse with your saddle and the horse has wide eyes, ears come back, ask your question. Is that really my horse or is he just telling me something? So if you don't want to use whips and spurs, and if you don't want to fall in the trap of opinion, then I should say beg you, for the sake of the horses, follow the common sense, listen to body workers, physiotherapists, veterinarians, and of course, think about it. Would you as a guy ride in female underwear? Would you as a guy ride in female jeans? Never. Why would you ladies ride in the male saddle? Right, so we have saddles for war, we have saddles for work, and we have saddles for sport. One of the key problems we face today is that the modern horse gets bred more sensitive. In other words, they're a little bit more electric. That's what the high sport demands. Also, we have a massive problem that the modern horse from today are an upright rectangle. What's the problem with that? Okay, the old horses were a flat rectangle, broad chest, not so long legs, and for saddle makers, and for the sake of the life of the horse, and so the horse can move nicely, we have a nice, strong back. Today, we want the horses very electric, we want the horse's legs to swing further forward, never mind the hind leg, but they focus apparently only on the front. And in the saddle world, we have a new dilemma. We have the area where the saddle sits much, much shorter, so that 8 out of 9 saddles, like this one, sits in the rear of the saddle. And it's incredible how many people do not know that. This is so, you're looking from the back, the lumbar sacral is so flimsy. It is so thin. Just to reinsure, I can't show this enough. Here you see that first lumbar. Look how thin that bone is. Here's a the pen, you see how thick the pen is. So you can see how thin this is, and it's very, very fragile. Now you say, oh, my horse has a lot of muscles there. He will not hurt, and I'm a very light rider, and it's just a little bit too long. There's no such a thing as a little bit too long. If you're a father or a man and your girlfriend or daughter comes home and says, oh, daddy, or hey, honey, don't worry, I'm just a little bit pregnant. You would freak out, are you or you're not? And the same with saddles. There's no such a thing as little bit. Either the saddle is in the dark zone and hits these bones or not. Many people have no clue. The horse will deviate from it, will hollow. The biomechanics, I'm going to show you a couple of videos, will clearly indicate that the horse will go away. But will also go away all the space. This is the spine, the top of the spine is all grown together. It's kissing spine or overriding dorsal processes. Okay, the horse is a survival animal and will protect itself and deviates from pain when the saddle is too long, either in the front or in the back. Right? Most of the time it's in the back. You're looking from the back and you see the massive pressure there. And in motion, when the horse moves, okay, it will drive the saddle onto the shoulder. And when it drives onto the shoulder, you see massive dry spots. And on top of the shoulder, there's cartilage. You see the damage on the cartilage. And it's shown in so many pictures and in so many videos. And it's really sad to say that to this day, people think that the saddle should fit like a bridge. Call it the bridge fit. You dig here and dig here. You see in the middle here, it's hollow. So when the back comes up, then it will have nice even contact. But everything what goes up goes down. In other words, when we talk about biomechanics or movement of the horse, everybody wants to ride a horse which moves up and down and swings nice. In canter, you have this kind of a motion. The horse will not swing if you dig into the most sensitive area in the lumbar or in the front, or systematically cripple the horse's scapula. Here you see the tree digging into the shoulder. This is a horse laying on his right side, the left side. This is doing a dissection. The veterinarian shows the students. Here is a classic tree, wooden tree with two short tree points, the metal sticking out. Here you see the D-ring where you put your breastplate. So if you ever want to know how to measure the width of the tree, okay, you would measure it from D-ring to D-ring. You'd be surprised how many saddles are way too narrow there. If you want to know the angle, you would measure the angle from the D-ring to the point of that metal. That allows that shoulder to come through. Underneath the fascia here and underneath these muscles is the bone, and this here is the cartilage. This is the shoulder blade. You can see how it's been damaged from the saddle. So I cannot emphasize enough that if you want to have horses to move nice and free, oh, we got here going on, okay, then the horse needs to bring the back up, okay? It needs to come up so they don't touch. So we're going to talk about today about biomechanics. I don't think I can play this video. Let me see if I can trick it. Yay. So let's try that again. Here you go. I want you to see how much these muscles contract and elongate. And I play that quite often, this video, that this movement here in slow motion, you can see how the shoulder comes upwards, backwards. And when we talk about shoulder freedom, that means that the tree cannot be too long, because a saddle that's too long in the back gets pushed in motion forward. The scapula can rotate 6 to 8 inches backwards. Okay? So there's an old myth, especially in the English saddle fitting school, they say put the saddle tree 2 inches back, because the shoulder goes back 2 inches, minimum 4. Okay? So if you put your saddle 4 inches back, now what? You're sitting on the croup. Okay? So in order for the saddle to fit, you need the right width. So when the leg strides forward, that scapula can slide underneath without crippling the cartilage like you see here. So when I talk about biomechanics, OK, Okay. I never want to see a horse what trots like this, because this is you're too late. Okay. Here you see the neck is fused, the back is fused, there's no more movement. This horse is typical for Arabs. They have high pain threshold, and that horse has no neck, no back muscle. And yes, you could do spinal surgery, but very often when they do spinal surgery, they do it on top and they can't go all the way down underneath where they're all grown together. So before it goes to this stage where all this calcifies, it calcifies down here as well. Okay? And look how little that hole is versus that hole. This is normal. See these holes here? That's where the nerves come out, the spinal nerves. And if you ever know anybody or you ever had a pinched nerve in your back, game over. I mean, that is so painful. So horses will not say, ow, 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 okay? They will just guard themselves. And we can see in the movement problems. So as I said, we can cut through the top and cut the top of the spinal processes, but the bottom ones, you can't fix. So very often, this is just a nuisance from misinformation. And that's why, Mary Claire, you and I do what we do, correct? We want to make sure that people don't lose the horses because of some people's opinion.